to tonight's Pensions Committee meeting. Particularly pleased to welcome you here to Birkenhead Town Hall, and one of the reasons we decided to bring it to Birkenhead Town Hall was to make it more accessible. This committee meeting is made up of councillors not just from Wirralborough Council, who are the administering authority, but we also have representatives from other local authorities who are part of the Pensions Committee. So I'd like to welcome first of all of the members of the public who are here tonight. It's a pleasure to have you here. This is a meeting held in public, not a public meeting, but it's a real pleasure to have you with us here tonight. Welcome. We're going to make a statement about the pension fund's responsibility towards responsible investment and our investments in fossil fuels, and then we're also going to invite you to join separately with us, both Peter Wallach and myself, if you wish to diarise a date for further discussion, which I think might be useful. So, I'm going to go through our agenda items. Quite an extensive agenda item. Members of the public, you're more than welcome to stay in the hall of the meeting or leave when you think it's appropriate. But again, welcome to the Town Hall here at Birkenhead. So just to go through our agenda as we have it. First of all, we'd like to talk about members' code of conduct and any declarations of interest. So that we have, so George, yours is, your wife is a member.
Mother-in-law.
And my wife's a member of the scheme also. And you're a member.
Scheme member.
And we have what we call pension envy. The rest of us who aren't scheme members would like to be. So thank you for those declarations. We now have minutes of our last meeting, 21st of March 2017, which are found on pages 1 to 6. So I believe we have one correction that we need to make, Brian.
No, man's on the IMDP minutes later on.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, so we made a note of your apologies for that meeting. Hi. So, other than that, we're happy to approve the minutes as a correct record. Anyone would like to propose?
Yeah, I'm for one.
Second. Okay, thank you. So I'll just sign those minutes. Okay, so there's no matters arising from that minute. So what I'd like to do now is we'd like to make a statement. So for members of the public, Peter Wallach is the director of the pension fund. So we're going to make a brief statement on the pension fund's investment strategy in fossil fuels. I'd like to make a couple of comments, and then I'm more than happy then to look at a date. If there's a representative or a spokesperson for the group tonight, if you want to set a date for meeting at a later date, or we make contact details and we can make that arrangement, if that's okay. So over to Peter for a moment.
Yes, thank you, Paul. I think it'd be helpful just to say we're looking to get some information on our website. I'll only make a short statement this evening, but we'd like to get a bit more detailed information on there for you to look at. I'd also prepared a short presentation on the renewable investments that we've made, and I can say something about that if there's time. But in relation to your particular concerns, I think it would be fair to say that Merseyside Pension Fund recognises that it has assets within its investment portfolio that are at risk of becoming stranded in a 2-degree scenario. It will address this risk through a suitable decarbonisation plan that measures the fund's ownership responsibility for emissions, locates the areas within the public equities portfolio of highest carbon and reserves intensity, and implements a plan for rebalancing the portfolio that substantially reduces exposure to this intensity. The decarbonisation plan may involve a partial divestment of carbon-intensive assets, but full divestment of fossil fuels companies is not considered to be sufficiently in line with fulfilling the fund's investment objectives. The decarbonisation plan is similar to those being carried out by other leading European asset owners, such as ABP, which is a Dutch pension fund, AP4, which is a Swedish pension fund, and FRR, a French pension fund. MPF will continue to engage appropriately with fossil fuel companies in its ownership to require that they adequately review and align their business models towards transition to a low carbon economic future. We'll also continue to deploy capital into renewable energy. This is being carried out primarily through the fund's investments in infrastructure, recently increased to 7% of the strategic asset allocation. The projects supported include large and smaller scale wind, solar, hydro, and energy from waste projects in the UK and overseas. Sorry, that's a bit longer than perhaps I intended to make. But that's a summary, really, of additional information that we will be putting on our website, we trust, in the next few days.
Now, we do have copies of that statement, more than happy for you to get copies of it tonight and have the way. Just on a personal note, I'd just like to mention to the general public tonight that I'm proud of the fact that Merseyside Pension Fund are a leader in investment in renewable energy sources. We work with a company, Iona Capital, and we've invested in wind farms, in anaerobic digestion plants. And it's fair to say that Merseyside Pension Fund by far invests in renewable energies far more than any other local government sector pension scheme. That doesn't mean to say that we're doing enough. It doesn't mean to say there's a lot more we can do. But we are happy to engage with yourselves. I met recently with the chair of Shell Nigeria, and a meeting with him about what's going on with Shell in Lagos in Nigeria and all the issues they have. And we are aware of those issues, and perhaps there's a way divestment can move forward. But we just want to make you aware of the fact that as Merseyside Pension Fund, we do take our responsibilities seriously. But we also have fiduciary responsibilities that we have to bring in a return for our pensioners and that we have a responsibility for. So, what I'm going to suggest, if you'd like us to pass out our statements, if you've got any material you'd like to hand to members of the committee, I'm more than happy for you to pass that out to us tonight. And then if we could make a contact detail with a spokesperson of the group, we can make arrangements to meet at a separate date. So is there any information you'd like to pass out to us? Even if you just pass it to myself and we can make sure it's passed to the rest of the committee. Yeah, okay. Thank you. I'm going to make sure that this goes to all members of the committee. Thank you. And yeah, in fact, if you make a note of my, I'll give you my contact details.
Okay.
And which is Paul Doughty at.
How do you spell Doughty?
Yeah, Doughty. Doughty. At world.gov.uk. And if you use that email address, and we'll make arrangements to meet separately, Peter and myself. And also, we do have a member of our team at the pension fund called Owen Thorne, and he is the responsible investment officer for Merseyside Pension Fund. And other funds don't have that, you know, so I think it would be good to engage and to talk through where we are and where we can go in the future. Is that okay?
That's right.
You're more than welcome to stay for the rest of the meeting, as I said. You decide. Okay?
No, I think we will leave it to the meeting. Just thank you for agreeing to speak to us, and I think we commend that everything is moving in the right direction, and we'll look forward to speaking to you in more detail about this in future. But yeah, we commend you for listening and taking initial action on this. And we'll speak to you again in the future about
Thank
this.
So, I think that was a useful engagement, so
yeah.
Appreciate your patience with that item. So, we'd now like to go on with the rest of our tonight's agenda, and that is first of all agenda item 3, audit findings, and that's going to be presented to us by Grant Porter.
Thank you, Chair. You've got in front of you our audit findings report. My name is Grant Patterson, I'm the engagement lead for the pension fund audit, As a firm, what we do is we have specialist pension funds that lead auditors for special pension funds themselves, and then one major leads on the main council meeting of project audit. So today we're going to come to you to do a final report from our audit of the pension fund for this year, and in line with normal processes, we'll bring it to you as the pension committee, and we'll then go on to Wirral's audit and risk committee as those charged with governance before we sign off the council's financial statements. So in terms of our overall approach to the audit, as outlined on page 5, to your page 11, there's been no changes to the plan that you received right back in February, so on those significant changes. The one area we have had to change is that the fund itself was looking at its classification of investments. There's been a new guidance given out by the Pensions Resources Accounting Group, PRAG, which has provided that. And following a review of your own investments, you've moved some into level two, becoming into level two investments or level one. They became material, therefore, from our perspective, we've undertaken additional audit tests in relation to those. Overall, our audit is substantially complete. We have one or two minor queries that are outstanding, but nothing significant. And our normal elements of being a final review of the financial statements. And you have a draft letter representation in front of you today, which we will look for you to recommend up to the Audit and Risk Committee. And then we have to do, as auditors, a balance sheet event as close to the signing date as possible. So that means September when the main accounts get signed off. No changes to the net assets of statements as of the fund as reported at the end of March, which is just over £8 billion. And we are proposing to issue an unqualified audit opinion on the pension fund financial statements. In terms of the timing of the audit, as I'm sure those members are aware, next year local government accounts will be issued on by the end of July. We've traditionally looked to do the pension fund early. We've worked well with your team this year to bring the audit forward for the pension fund and the local authorities that council will come forward with next year. Your accounts were prepared to a good standard with good supporting working papers and a small number of members, which I prefer to relate, are mainly in disclosure areas rather than unadjusted or adjusted errors that we found as part of our audit. Turning over to page 12, as I'm sure members of the committee are aware, we are also responsible for looking at internal controls. The one element that we need to bring to your attention is around internal audit findings, around lump sums, which are we've considered the nature of those errors and there's no risk of material misstatements, and we are aware that management has taken actions to address the weaknesses of the internal audit found. I think we also like to know, in a positive way, that the fund itself actually reviews the internal control report that you receive from your investment managers, and whilst there might be some identify some weaknesses in those are nothing that's impacted upon our audit of the pension fund itself, and I think in discussion with Donna and her team, we'll be getting a report around that work, because it is an additional governance role that the fund undertakes that people will be aware of in terms of giving you assurance as a committee. So moving on to the main audit itself, looking at page 14, we haven't changed our materiality levels and we haven't changed the areas we're looking at. In terms of our significant risks that we reported to you on, which are now on page 15, two of those are what we have introduced as part of the standards, that's revenue recognition, a standing significant risk that the auditing standards require us to look at. We normally rebut those for pension funds, mainly because your main income is through our contributions, which is easy for relatively easy for us to check and audit, and also for investment income, which again is normally straightforward for us to audit. So we do rebut that, and our audit work actually on the work of the fund this year has shown no areas for us to give concern in terms of income to the fund. We also have to see management override of controls. If someone's going to, create loss to the fund or elements like that, then we see that the main way they will do that would be somehow hiding, if they're going to hide what they were doing, would be through journal entries around the financial statements. Therefore, we focus a lot of our audit work around that. And in particular, we have to say that our review of journals has revealed no issues and we found no evidence of management override of control. It's an assumption that we have to have as auditors. It's not to say that your officers or members or members are acting anyway inappropriately. We just don't assume that's a part of our skepticism. But we found no issues that would give us cause for concern in that area. And then the other significant risk, and these are at risk where we would undertake a little bit more audit work and processes, are around valuation due level 3 investments. As a fund, we have a significant number of those. And those are where it's not easily observable valuations or inputs to the valuation mechanism. And what we normally do those is we do sample test those. We look to go back to the main accounts or some of the fund holders, and where necessarily we'll if those are depending on when those year ends are, we would need to look forward about cash flows. So we've done that, and there aren't any issues again that we wish to bring to your attention. The thing with level 3 investments is you and in most you won't really know what the true value is until you can't sell them. Because of the very nature of them, there'll be infrastructure, they'll be looking ahead, things like that. So it's at the point at which you come to recognise that asset is the only one the true value will come through. I won't go too much on to pages 17 and 18. These are where we consider the reasonable probable risks with material statement as a firm. And again, there are no significant issues coming out of that. They're the areas you expect us to look at: our investment income, purchases and sales of investments. As I say, the level 2 investments, where you recategorise them this year or move them into level 2, and the contributions, benefits payable. And finally, we do look at member data. Probably just to say that it's around rights and obligations, and we look at member data in the sense of how it drives figures in the accounts. What we're not looking at is a full review of your member data that's held on the pension system. So it is focused on or through the lens of the impacts that comes through into the financial statements. Probably the one thing to bring to your attention actually on page 13 of Adam, page 19 of your report is this year for 16 and 17, fair value disclosures, pension funds weren't required to account under IFRS 13 last year. That exemption has been removed this year, so pension funds now, in a similar way to the administrative authorities, have to look at their assets and through a fair value lens. And we were looking at whether the disclosures in the accounts were fully compliant. I think there were some areas where we were having discussions with the fund around those level 3 investments and some sensitivity disclosures. You've consulted with your experts, and they were sort of saying that in their view, given the complexity of your investment strategy, it's not easy for them to come up in a way with a composite figure to say level 3s could go up and down by a certain amount. And it's not easy, I think, personally, for the fund to actually calculate it itself. So you do rely on our experts for that. So what we've looked at that, and we're satisfied with the fund's response this year. And again, I think it's something we'll look at going forward. And there are other disclosures that you feel that, as a fund, you've covered enough areas of the annual report and financial statements. So we've looked at those, and we're satisfied that, whilst there might not be sort of full compliance, those omissions do not represent a significant over-representation of the financial statements for a reader. And I think that's something that we'll look to work with on the fund as that area develops going forward. I know we mentioned the fair value hierarchy and the fact that you've looked at your level 2 investments. The other pages, we do look at accounting policies, estimates and judgments. There's nothing to report to you, we're all happy with those. And there are other matters to communicate to you with that link on your page 21. Probably the one just on there is this level of representation, and we will be asking for a substantive one, not asking for any specific disclosures. And then on page 22 is the issue around internal audit that we've mentioned, that I mentioned earlier. And then on page 17, those misclassifications, those are changes that we picked up. We've documented those here for your information. And that's where I will stop. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Is there any questions for Adam? Okay. So we're happy to note the report that presented to us tonight. So there are a couple of items in the exempt that we'll be able to look at later. But I'm happy to note the report. Thank you. Thanks for your presentation. Okay, our next agenda item is our statement of accounts. And Donna, you may roll on and do the agenda items to follow, or one at a time?
Just to note for members, agenda item 4 and agenda item 5, but there's links between them, and statements of accounts on agenda item 4 can be found within agenda item 5, if that makes sense. But agenda item four, the purpose of this report is to present members with the audited statement of accounts for Merseyside Pension Fund for 2016-17 and to respond to the previous item on this agenda, the audit findings report from Grant Thornton. As just stated, the statements of accounts are included with MPF's draft annual report and that can be found on page 82 to 111 of the pack. The value of the fund as at 31st of March 2017 was $8.2 billion. I don't propose to go through the accounts at this meeting, but I'm happy to take any questions. The accounts have been subject to external audit over the summer and the previous item includes the findings of that very detailed review. As Grant Thornton indicated within their report, the accounts were prepared and available for audit by the 31st of May, a month ahead of the statutory deadline. The audit was also undertaken to a revised timetable in preparation for the revised statutory deadline for coming to force for 2017-18 reporting. In response to the Grant Thornton report, officers have agreed to the suggested adjustments to the disclosures. Within the audit findings report, under controls on page 12 of the pack, the auditor, as Justine said, brings your attention to two issues. Section 2.5 of my report responds to those issues raised and reports that the control environment has been further strengthened for the payment of pensions and that the outcome of internal control reviews of our external mandates will be reported to Governance and Risk Working Party going forward. The Grant Thornton report also refers to a small number of fair value measurement disclosures that were maybe not fully compliant with the code. 2.6 of my report responds to this and informs members that some of the requirements had been reflected in other notes to the accounts, and where it was not, in preparing the accounts, the fund liaised with the independent advisor and the information was not available. The fund will continue to work with its advisors, with the fund managers, and SIPFAC, along with Grant Thornton, upon this matter. Overall, the Grant Thornton report is a positive report and reflects the hard work undertaken by fund officers. 2.7 of the report informs members that a letter of representation has been prepared on behalf of this committee, which gives assurances to the auditor on various aspects relating to the pension fund. This letter will be signed by the Section 151 officer and the Chair of Audit and Risk Management Committee following that committee in September. Section 13 asks members of Pensions Committee, subject to clearance of outstanding matters, to approve the audited statements of accounts for 2016-17, consider the amendments to the accounts, the audit findings report and the letter of representation. Section 13 also asks members of Pensions Committee on approval and consideration of previous points to refer the recommendation to the Audit and Risk Management Committee. There is a statutory requirement to bring this item to committee as detailed within Section 14. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
Chair, could I suggest an additional recommendation, as mentioned by Brian Thornton in the previous item and by Donna at 2.2. As prepared and available forwarded by 31st of May 2017, a month ahead of the statutory deadline, also been undertaken to a revised timetable in preparation for revised statutory deadlines that come into force in 2017-18 reporting. So can I suggest that we congratulate Donna and her team and all the officers for achieving this? It really is quite remarkable.
You'll agree with that, sure.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. Thanks for that report presentation. Any more questions or comments? So we're happy to note the recommendations in section 13.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you. Okay, so on to agenda item 5, Donna.
So the purpose of this report is to provide members with the draft annual report of Merseyside Pension Fund for 2016-17. A copy of the annual report is attached in the appendices. The LGPS regulations require the pension fund annual report to contain the fund account, the net asset statement and supporting notes as discussed in the previous meeting, along with other sections as detailed within the document presented before you. Section 13 asks members of Pensions Committee to approve the annual report for publication as required by the LGPS regulations. Thank you, Chair. We're happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? No? So again, we're happy to note the recommendation, section 13, that we approve the report.
Chair, just from our side, we will be issuing an opinion on the annual report as well, and that proposal would be consistent with the financial statements that have been approved. So the roadmap proposal is to issue an annual report of consistency opinion.
And once that's issued, we will actually the publication of the annual report will be following the audit in this management committee.
That's it. Yeah, I think that's all. Okay. So I'm happy with that recommendation again. As Jeff mentioned, thank you to Paula and the staff for working this way. Okay, so agenda item 6, the budget outturn. Again, yourself, Donna.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members note and approve the outturn for 2016-17 financial year, the finalised budget for 2017-18 financial year, and the three-year budget as required by the annual report. Members will recall Pensions Committee received a paper in January on the budget, and it was agreed that I would bring finalised figures to this meeting. The appendix of that report is in January is included as Appendix 2 to this paper. The actual outturn for the last financial year and the finalised budget for this financial year can be found in Appendix 1 to this report. The actual outturn for 2016-17 is £19.8 million, in line with that projected outturn as reported in committee in January. The finalised budget for 17-18 is £20.9 million. Section 2.3 of the report highlights to members the variances that since the report in January, and that is that staffing now reflects updated salary and salary-related recharges, and central establishment recharges have been updated. Section 2.4 to 2.6 of the report details the three-year budget for MPF for inclusion in the annual report. As previously reported, SIFA's best practice for the contents of the financial performance report includes a three-year budget. Approval is sought to include the three-year budget in this year's annual report, although annual budgets will still be brought to Pensions Committee for approval. Section 7 of this report explains the costs of the pension fund are charged directly to the pension fund and then ultimately recovered by investment income and employee and employer contributions. This report recommends in Section 12 that members note the actual outturn for 2016-17, approve the finalised budget for 17-18 and approve the inclusion of the three-year estimates in the 2016-17 annual report. The approval of the budget forms part of the government's arrangements of Merseyside Pension Fund. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Donna, for that presentation. Brian?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Through you, can I just clarify? I think I'm right in saying that extra staffing have been agreed to be brought in to do additional work that's there. Does the cost of that, are the extra staffing, is that included in all the figures and the reports that we've had from Donna today?
The proposed staffing review that is currently out for consultation, any costs associated for that that refer to 17-18 have been reflected fully in this.
And that's a real positive story that we've been able to recruit more staff to assist in all areas of the fund, and that's a real positive move forward.
Yeah, just a question on page 126, the investment fees, which are budgeted to go from 14.1 to 16.1. Can you just get a bit of clarity around or detail around the reason for that?
There's some, it doesn't take into account any of the work associated with pooling. It is just if things stay the same and with the assumptions by long-term assumptions by the actuary in terms of the increase in asset values, that's how those figures have been pulled together.
So they're a reflection of the budgeted increase, the anticipated increase in asset values.
That's correct.
Yes. Bumps up the
investment. And assuming that fees stay the same and it does not take into account any pooling. But as stated, this is a requirement for the annual report for a three-year budget. Any annual budget will still come to this committee and be approved on an annual basis and will reflect more known information. At this point, some assumptions have been made for that three-year budget because the information is just not known at this time.
It's a good question, and we don't know what the cost implications of the money would be just yet. I mean, the purpose of pooling was to bring assets together and to bring about savings, but certainly in the first initial years there won't be any savings to Mercer pension, but there will be an increased cost. So, but again, those figures are unknown, but it's a good point to raise. Any other questions? Can I ask Peter actually to comment? Because if you actually look at the, you know, I mean, our fund is now valued at 8.2 billion, you know, which is a good steady increase. Every time you look at the asset value, it seems to go up. So, percentage wise, we're very competitive, not the right word, is it? But we're good value, so that, you know, the fund gives good value to its members, I believe. Is a comment on 7.1 there, Peter, how those percentages work? Because there's ongoing savings there.
Yes, I did look back. That last figure, that 0.17% that we report as the cost of the fund against assets, that was 0.19 in 15-16. So although 0.02% reduction might seem quite small, that is virtually a 10% reduction in the relative cost of the fund to assets. Clearly that's been helped by the increase in the value of the assets of the fund, but on the basis most investment fees are on a pro rata basis, it does demonstrate that we are managing to reduce overall costs as best we can.
Which is good, as well as Brian mentioned, bringing more stipend to the fund, because the pressures on the staff over the last couple of years have been tremendous. So it's a good report overall. Thank you for that. We're happy to note the recommendation there. Thank you. Okay, so on to agenda item 7, which is a local government pension scheme update, which in the absence of Yvonne tonight, Peter will present to us.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The report covers four areas. Firstly, under section 2.1, there are some headlines from the Scheme Advisory Board's annual report, which is effectively the amalgamation of all 88 schemes in England and Wales, which is set out under section 2.2. I don't necessarily propose to read those headlines, but you can see that membership of the LGPS continues to increase. There was actually no change to the total assets of the LGPS. In terms of performance, that's the third bullet point. The average return was 0.1%. It's encouraging that Merseyside managed to return 1.2% against the median fund last year. Again, an increase in liabilities, but an overall funding level of 85%. Our funding level is 84.8%, so very much in line with the median fund. And then finally, a suite of health indicators. The fund did support the board in developing those and piloting the scheme for them. Under section 2.5, academies are something which we've mentioned before. There's work ongoing between the board and the PwC in terms of options for academies. That continues to develop, and there'll be further updates to this committee in relation to that. A survey of the new governance arrangements, particularly in relation to local pension boards, and both the chair of committee and the chair of pension board responded to that survey. Then finally, under section 2.10, the pensions regulator is highlighting to us under 2.12 his priorities for this year, which are scheme governance, record keeping, internal controls, and then member communication. There's a further item later on this agenda which partially addresses those matters, but it tells Yvonne and the team the things that will be at the top of the regulator's list of priorities. So the report is for information, and members are asked to note the report.
Any questions? So we're happy to note the report.
Yeah.
Okay. you. Right, so agenda item 8 is an update on Poolen. Before Peter makes his presentation, I would like to say that obviously progress on Poolen has been interrupted with the elections and the like, but we do know Peter's schedule to move this item forward, but Peter will talk us through.
Yes, thank you, Chair. It's a short report. It's slightly out of order because the appendices are in the exempt part of the agenda, but those exempt appendices are the submission that the pool made to DCLG, and we can cover those later on. So the report is for information, and members are asked to note the report.
So we were given deadlines to meet with the Department of Community and Local Government, and we met their deadlines, and okay, no questions on that, to note the report. Right, and again, Peter is going to talk us through agenda item 9, which is a transparency code for the government.
Yes, thank you. The code of transparency is a voluntary code that's being proposed by the Scheme Advisory Board. Under section 2, I set out the background to the purpose of the code, which is to provide additional disclosure around the fees that investment managers charge. We've always been supportive of this, and this is a code that, as I say, managers will sign up to on a voluntary basis, but we're certainly encouraging our investment managers to sign up. Other pension funds are doing that as well, and the intention is that those investment managers will provide a regular return to pension funds of their fees and of the costs that the mandates have incurred. As a consequence of having that information, there's the opportunity for it to be analysed by funds to have a better idea of managing those costs and enabling funds to engage with asset managers with a view clearly to bringing those costs down. So that's really covered under section 2. Under section 8, at this stage, it's just in relation to listed assets. MPF has a lot of unlisted assets in infrastructure and property in private equity. We're doing a great deal of work with the internal team in identifying and collecting that information with a view to analysing it appropriately, and that is involving a fair amount of staff time and resource, but we think it's well worthwhile and is required to pooling that we report transparently and in a clear way on our costs, and it's important that other funds and other pools do that so that the public has assurance about the way in which the scheme is being administered. So the report is for members to note.
Okay, so a lot of work, but as Peter said, worthwhile to improve the transparency to the general public and our pension members. So we're happy to note the report. Okay, so pleased to have with us tonight John Raisin, who's the chair of our pensions board for Merseyside Pension Fund, and John is going to do a presentation on the annual report to us tonight.
Thank you, Chair. This is the second report I've brought to the Pensions Committee on the work of the Pensions Board. You remember I brought from 2015-16 to your meeting September last year, so I imagine we'll get a little bit quicker this year. This review covers the period from May 2016 to 31st of May 2017. This review was considered by the Pension Board on the 27th of June and approved by the Board, and consequently, in accordance with the terms of reference of the Pension Board, I'm now presenting to you as the Pensions Committee, the decision-making body. As you know, the Pension Board consists of 9 members, and they can set up essentially to broaden the representation of employers, particularly non-council employers, within the pension fund governance arrangements, and also to enhance the representation of employees. So there are 4 employer reps and there are 4 employee reps, and myself as independent chair. We are required to meet at least twice a year, but we've determined to meet 3 times a year. We met 3 times during the last financial year. The agenda of the Pension Board is on the second page of the report, on page 152. Those are the items to be considered, and that's in accordance with the work plan, which was agreed by the 9 members of the board after consultation with the Director of Pensions. Given it's an employer and employee body, we focus particularly on governance because that really is our role. Within that, I think we have a particular focus on pensions admin because obviously employers are crucial to making sure that the pensions admin team, which heads up where you've actually received the correct information, because ultimately the employers are the source of information through to the fund. And also for employees, obviously, the fact of it's a defined benefit scheme, their benefits are guaranteed, whatever the investment performance is, but to get the benefit, they have to have the right record broadly. So for them, as well, the members, the whole issue of pensions admin is crucial. So that's an area we're particularly focused on, and I must thank particular Peter and Yvonne for the fact that they have brought to us detailed pensions admin reports, which I think have been very clear to the members of the board that the pensions admin is being performed well and positively in an extremely complicated area. That's given us a lot of assurance. We've had reports with detailed KPIs in there, which we asked for and we received. So I'm very pleased to report on that. And a very positive view of the board's form of pensions admin as administered by the Merseyside Fund. I think the other big element with receiving reports, like most of it have been in the confidential agenda necessarily so, is on pooling. And Peter has brought to us a large volume of information on that. And again, he has assured the board that the way that pooling has been approached by the Northern Board is appropriate to the needs of the three constituent authorities. So obviously there are 8 pools across the country now. I only know the detail of one of them, which is the London pool, the so-called London SIP, because I work with three of the London funds. But obviously, you know, across the country, the constituent ACA's LGPS is very different. The three which constitute your pool are of particular nature and type, particular internal range are very large. Again, the board has received assurance from the detail we've received that the approach is appropriate. And, I think last year we actually commended that approach to you really for. We didn't feel it appropriate to make any recommendations to the Pensions Committee during the year, which again is positive because we looked at we felt we would be able to contend with. I would say that during the last year, I felt as chair, the members of the board actually contributed very positively. They asked a lot of questions of the officers, not prompted by me, by the way. I would also like to just to record that Phil Goodwin, one of our members, died, and Phil did a lot to positively work with us when we set up the board. He'd been on the Pensions Committee previously. He was a very positive influence, and that's very sad. And he died at a very untimely moment. So just like to place that on record. Women with statutory duties, you know, the legislation is strange. Pension Committee members are not under a requirement under statutory duties. I know you do to a great extent, but we are. That has been covered at each committee. We've adopted the CIPFA knowledge and skills framework, and we're working through that. I'm glad to report that a number of members went on a 3-day LGPS fundamentals. I've also represented the board at the CIPFA pensions board updates. 68 members, because obviously we had one vacancy, attended the employer seminar last year where obviously we received board updates on the fund specifically. You delegated us a role in considering breaches of the law. I'm pleased to report that there were non-identified body officers, and neither did we identify the breaches of the law during 2016-17. The costs of the pension board, as we record to report to you, are detailed on page 155 of the agenda, and I thank Donna for providing those. There was a proposed work plan 2017-18 on page 155, which again was developed in consultation with the officers and then been approved by the board. And finally, and crucially, the effectiveness of the law, you know, obviously depends on the number